Hi, thanks for joining me today. I'm going to take you through the step-by-step process for achieving really successful oil rouging. I'm using my new line of brushes, and they are pointed round blenders. One thing I want to say off right from the start is when you're doing oil rouging, you must use a natural hair brush, not a synthetic. So I'm going to take you through the step-by-step process, how I mix my colors, a little side trick there, but also how I incorporate the brushes. So we're going to take a quick break, and I'm going to set up my work area, and then I'm going to take you through the entire process. Okay, now we're going to begin the process. Okay, now we're going to start the process. The first thing I want to talk to you about is the paints that I'm using. If you look over here, I've got the assortment of paints, and these are Martin F. Weber. I've got my gel transparentizer, which is a very important part of my technique, and then I've got the four colors that I use. I like to incorporate Payne's Gray, Burnt Umber, Alizarin Crimson Permanent, and Cad Yellow Medium. Also, I would like to point out, too, that you don't have to use the same line of paints that I use. If you have Grumbacher paints, Winsor Newton, Archival, they all work. The only thing you have to be really careful of is the gel transparentizer. It's a special formulation. Later on, when we get into talking about brush care and maintenance, I'm going to explain more about the gel transparentizer. So first of all, let's look at the brushes that I'm using. And I'm going to bring these over here so you can see. First of all, I have a couple of Q-tips, and the Q-tips are a very important part of my technique because I use them with a little bit of Windex for correcting my pen and ink on whatever surface that I'm working on, but I also use the Q-tips for bringing up highlights when I incorporate the oil rouging. Now, in the cup of Q-tips, I've got a liner brush, I've got my mini scumbler, I've got my small scumbler, and a large scumbler. These brushes have been isolated from the brushes that I have over here, which are the brushes that I use for rouging. And then I have a few other tools that I want to talk to you about. The reason I have incorporated four of the different size brushes for applying paint is, logically, you think about it, you've got tiny little areas like small berries where you want to add color, and you wouldn't want to use the biggest scumbler for applying paint. The scumblers are used more for background. So the liner brush is going to be our biggest focus brush as far as applying paint. And like I said before, I separated the paint brushes, the paint application brushes, from the blenders. So this way, when I'm working with new students, it helps them understand that you have to visually, mentally, physically separate your paint brushes from the blenders. Now, let's talk about these blenders. These are my new line of brushes, and what I've incorporated is five sizes. Now, I sell a set of my blenders, and the basic set of blenders incorporates the size 4, the size 6, a size 10, and the size 12 blender. These brushes basically are everything that I need to work on, anything from 16 by 20 canvases all the way down to my small little glass pieces that I work with. I have an additional brush that I've incorporated, and that is a number 2, I call it my little baby blender. It's half of the size of the number 4 blender, and that's something you can pick up on the side if you desire to. So I have my blender brushes laying on the table. The brushes that are incorporated into the cup of Q-tips, I jokingly refer to as my paint putter-oners. This helps the students understand that you use a specific brush for applying paint. When you're not using that brush, it goes back into the cup of Q-tips, so it keeps your work area nice and clean. And then I incorporate my different size blender brushes for executing the oil rouging. So next thing I want to talk about is my paints and my colors. Okay, I've got my palette set up here. And you might think this is kind of funny, but I really, when I'm travel teaching, I really like using styrofoam plates for palettes. It's great for mixing your paint. What I like about the styrofoam plate versus using palette paper is when you're mixing your color, you can actually scrape and look at the residue that's left on the palette, and that will show you what your oil color is going to look like when you execute the rouging. So I'm going to incorporate showing you my different color mixes. First of all, let's talk about the green that I'm using in this picture, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a small amount of Payne's Gray. You use very little oil paint and medium for this technique, so you've got to start with small increments of paint. And I'm going to take Cad Yellow and mix Cad Yellow into my Payne's Gray. Blue and yellow make green. So what I'm going to do here is incorporate the yellow into the Payne's Gray until, as I'm mixing and I'm scraping and look at the color stain that's left on the palette, I can compare this to the leaves on my picture and say to myself, yeah, that's looking pretty good. So there's my green mix. I'm going to wipe my palette knife off. The next color that I want to incorporate is this kind of a drab brown. So burnt umber by itself is pretty cinnamon looking. So what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to incorporate a little bit of burnt umber and a tiny bit, just a little bit of Payne's Gray into the umber. And when I mix this, it's going to take the umber and change it from a cinnamon brown to more of a deep chocolate. And keep incorporating tiny little bits of paint, just a little at a time so you don't waste your paint, until when you scrape the palette and you look at the stain and compare it to the picture in the pattern packet or book, you can compare that and say to yourself, yeah, that looks like a pretty good mix. Every time you mix your paint, you're never going to be able to mix it the same, so don't even go there. Okay, now I'd like to back up a little bit. What I want to do is get a close-up picture of the sample that I'm working with, so you can actually see when I scrape the color and I expose the stain, how the color works with the colors in the actual picture. Okay, so this is going to give you a little bit easier way of judging how your color mixing is going. The next color that I want to incorporate is the kind of lilac-y color into the background. So I'm going to take a little bit of alizarin crimson permanent. I'm going to bring it to a clean spot on the palette, and I want to show you two interpretations of the red. If I put a tiny pin dot of Payne's Gray into my alizarin crimson permanent, it turns it into almost like a berry, kind of a raspberry color tone. But oil paint is so versatile for mixing. Watch what I do if I take a little bit of my alizarin crimson permanent, I'm going to shorten and say ACP. Take a little bit of my ACP, and instead of putting the Payne's Gray, I'm going to put tiny pin dots of burnt umber, and look at the transformation in my red. It goes from a bluish purpley red to a gorgeous, almost holiday red. This is great for Christmas themed pictures. I love it for when I'm incorporating red apples. And you can see there's a brownish tint because I added the umber, and there's my purpley tint because I worked the Payne's Gray into the ACP. Now, just a little sidebar. I want to show you how versatile this paint is. Say you're doing pumpkins and squash, okay? If you take a little bit of Cad Yellow Medium, bring that to a clean spot on the palette, add tiny bits of umber to it. This is amazing how you can just take these four colors and achieve so many different color mixes. So here's a really pretty kind of an ochre-y color. You can see that the paint in the pile is very dark and brown, but as I expose the stain on the palette, you see that gorgeous gold coming through. So that's your pumpkin color. Also, when I painted my granddaughter, when I oil rouged Elizabeth on the porcelain plate that I did, I used this gold mix for her blonde hair. Next color I want to show you is pumpkin mix. You take a little bit of your Cad Yellow, bring it to a clean spot on the palette, add tiny bits of the ACP, alizarin crimson permanent, to the yellow, mix it, and you get a really pretty pumpkin orange. But to make it a little bit more softer on the eye, what I'm going to do is incorporate tiny, tiny bits, just teeny bits of burnt umber into the orange mix, and that brings it down a little bit so it's not so electric looking. And look at how pretty that is. The last color that I want to show you is an important color I use because I do a lot of shading. I'd like to point you back into the actual sample that I'm working with because I want to point out a few things. Do you notice the reflective shadow from the little twig perch and how I've got the shadow cast onto the birdhouse, the shadow underneath the eaves, the shadow that the leaf incorporates? These are important factors also into as far as bringing realism into your pictures. So when I mix this color, shadows aren't actually a color, they're just gray. So I'm going to take a little bit of Payne's Gray, bring it to a clean spot on the palette, and then I'm going to incorporate tiny bits of burnt umber into it. And what that's going to give me is a neutral gray-black that doesn't look like brown, it doesn't look like blue, it just looks like what a shadow would look like if it was cast underneath a leaf. Okay, this is an important color in my palette. So again, let's recap this.
I incorporated Payne's Gray with Cad Yellow to make my pretty earthy green. I started with burnt umber and I added tiny bits of Payne's Gray to it to create the color that I use for my birdhouse roof. Then I've got my gold color where I incorporated tiny bits of umber into Cad Yellow medium to create that ochre color. I've got my pumpkin shade, which isn't pertinent to this picture, but I just thought I'd throw it in there for you. And that is Cad Yellow with alizarin crimson permanent and a tiny smidgen of burnt umber to drab it down. I've got my two versions of red. I've got my apple red, which is alizarin crimson permanent with tiny bits of burnt umber added. And then I've got my crimsony berry red, which is alizarin crimson permanent with tiny bits of Payne's Gray added. And last but not least is my shadow color, and that is Payne's Gray with tiny bits of umber added. And look at the difference in these two mixes, and basically they're both the same colors. Here I started with my umber, made that my dominant color, and added bits of Payne's Gray to drab it down, and then I did the opposite to create my gray. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring my sample over, and we're going to start to get into what the oil rouging is all about. So I'm going to move my palette off to the side here. And another thing that I'm incorporating in my technique, along with my palette knife, I've got a clicker retractable eraser, and I've got a makeup brush, or a mop brush that you could use. And this is for helping you with correction work. I'm going to move my paints out of the way now so I can make a little bit more room. And I'm going to bring my sample over. Okay. Now, regarding my sample, here I've got my original. And you can see that what I've done with this is I've taken the pattern and I've transferred it onto a piece of scrapbook paper and I decoupaged it onto my surface. This is MDF. And the surface has been decoupaged and sprayed, and now I'm ready to start my oil rouging. One thing I want to bring into the view here is something that I think is very important, especially for beginners. This is just an inexpensive Lazy Susan, a lightweight plastic piece that I got at Walmart. And it's very important when you're oil rouging to make sure that you're always working in a comfortable direction. And I say for the best result, your rouging should be applied so that you can draw the color towards you. So if you have a little Lazy Susan, you can turn your work very easily, and it helps reinforce that little reminder that you have to turn your work. So I'm going to move it out of the way of the camera right now, and we're going to get started. Okay, so I've got my sample right close by, so you can see both of them. And what we're going to do now is we're going to get really up close so you can see exactly how I'm adding the paint to my surface. When I'm working on a decoupage surface, this is something that I talk about in my classes all the time. The more slick and shiny your surface is, the less gel you need to make your paint move. So when I'm incorporating decoupage now with the scrapbook paper as a background, there's so much of a sealer over the surface that I find the gel is almost not even necessary to incorporate. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my liner brush and I'm going to work it into my burnt umber mix. And we're going to get really up close with this so you can see how I lay the paint onto the surface. And I'm going to start right here. And you notice that as I'm laying the paint, I'm kind of dabbing it, but in no way am I adding a thick goop of paint. It's just a wide area of paint. Set up one area at a time, and then I'm going to incorporate my blender brushes. Now, what I like to tell my students is just like the rules in side loading or floating, the bigger the brush you use, the better the float, depending on the size of the area that you're working in. So you might think I'm kind of crazy for using a number 10 blender, but I've got such a wide area to work in that I don't need to worry about the paint not moving or not the brush not fitting into that area. So you can see how I'm incorporating with my blending. I'm rouging in a circular motion. Sometimes I call it tamping, where I press to soften the color. Other times I'll rouge in a circular motion. It depends on how much space you have to work in the area that you're rouging. So I'm incorporating this. And what I want to do with this piece is I'm not going to have you sit and watch me paint the whole piece. I'm going to highlight on some of the important areas. Your paper towel is very important. I've got paper towel folded in fourths, so as I'm rouging, I can constantly be swirling my brushes, just like a good mop brush. You want to be able to clean your brush off properly and maintain the nice, dry, fluffy effect that you're looking for. Setting a little bit more color, maybe try a little bit smaller brush. I've got my number 6 here. The smaller brushes have a little bit more of a tightness to them, and so what you have to do is you have to figure out, okay, how much sealer do I have? How slick is my surface? How is that oil color going to incorporate over the surface? What you could do too is try to incorporate a tiny bit of gel in with your paint, but be very careful, because if you over add your gel, you could make the paint so greasy as soon as you touch it with a blender brush, it would disappear. See how I set up that small little area? Now I'll go to my smaller blender again. Remember to maintain the swirling effect or the tamping effect. And I'm going to soften that color down away from the point of origin. Now let's talk about mistakes. Oh my goodness, I just got a little bit of my umber into my leaf. All you need is a dry Q-tip, and all you have to do is go in and lift out unwanted color. If you felt like you were painting a little bit too heavily, you could take this dry Q-tip and actually go in and literally remove excess paint that you don't want. So you are very, very much in control. So I can just keep incorporating. And then maybe the next time, try a smaller blender brush. Now this is an important factor too. When you're oil rouging, I want you to really notice how my brush is positioned on my surface. I'm not straight up in the brush like this, going like this. What I'm doing is I'm taking the brush on its side. The tip of the brush goes into the area where my paint is the darkest. So this way I'm not going outside my pattern lines, and then I'm working the color away from that point of origin. So this way, what you end up as your result is a look of a really, really well executed float. You want a dark to medium to light value progression, which ends at nothing. Okay, so I'm going to incorporate that. Now let's talk about changing colors, and let's work on something like the leaves. Okay, the first thing I want to do is I'm going to designate one spot on my palette for cleaning, and I'm going to take a little bit of gel and I'm going to work it into that area and express the excess color out of my brush. Then I'm going to pinch wipe the brush between paper towel, and then I'm going to go into my next color. And what's really cool about this is you don't have to completely clean your brushes between color changes, because as you work the gel into the paint, you express the paint out onto your paper towel. When you work into your next color, it neutralizes whatever was in your color in your brush from before. So now let's work on a leaf. So I'm going to pick on this leaf right here. What I'm going to do is, as you reference the photo, this is what I tell my students. Your photo is your roadmap for color placement. What I do when I'm teaching is I don't tell the students step by step where to lay the paint. What I do is I encourage them to look at the photo. Notice where the paint is the darkest. Do you see how I turn my work? So I'm rouging in a comfortable direction. And because I'm working in a smaller area, I want to maintain three value balance, but I'm being very, very careful to not end up with that leaf looking completely painted in. There's a little turn over here, so I'm going to put a little color under here. Now I'll use my little tiny number 2 blender to get into these tiny little areas. Again, the brush is on its side. It's almost, when you look at it, it's flat, but the tip of the brush, the point, is where my color is the strongest, so I can maintain control. Swirl the brush in paper towel. My next area, I'm laying color right next to the vein. And notice how I'm putting my brushes back into the cup of Q-tips. So this way I keep my work area nice and clean. Now I'll turn my work and continue to rouge to complete that leaf. Okay, so going from there, let's think about the blue that's in the actual birdhouse, the body of the birdhouse. I'm going to switch to my mini scumbler brush because I've got a lot larger area, so I don't have to work as diligently with the rouging because I can incorporate a bigger brush. So I'm taking straight Payne's gray, and what I'm going to do is take the brush again on its side, Do you notice how the tip of the bristles is not going over the line? So I'm staying inside my pattern lines. But because I'm using the small, the really tiny scumbler, I can cover more territory, and then I have, now I have to work as hard when I incorporate the rouging. Take my little bit bigger blender, again, on its side, the point of the brush, the subtle, gentle point goes into the area where my color is the darkest, and then I will distribute that color, graduating it from dark to medium to light. This is a good project for a beginner student because basically you're spending a lot of time working on the inside of the pattern, so it teaches you really good brush control. I wanted to point out something else too. When I teach, I always work on my subject first. Then what I do is I apply my matte spray to dry the oil paint, and then I go in and I infuse my background colors afterwards. So if we look at the background colors here, I've got my blue in the background, I've got a little bit of my crimson color. So what I would do for this is I would incorporate a little bit bigger scumbler brush. Take a little tiny bit of clean gel, go into the area where you scuff the paint, pick up a little bit of straight Payne's gray. Now I'm gonna turn my work a little bit and I'm gonna incorporate some of this Payne's gray into my background. I'm gonna take my largest blender, which is the number 12. The brush is flat again, never straight up on its tip, flat, and in a circular motion, I'm rouging that color into the background. Now let's see what happens when I incorporate a little bit of my crimson color. I'm just gonna scuff the brush and paper towel a little bit, pick up a tiny little bit of the ACP mixed with a little bit of the Payne's gray, little teeny bit of gel, and let's see what it looks like when I incorporate some of this rosy color into the background. Turn my work and rouge that. And you have to remember that the birdhouse, the leaves, all of the details have been spray dried with my matte spray. The instructions are in my pattern packet. So when you incorporate your colors at the end to kind of tie everything together, it's very easy to take that Q-tip, and if you end up with paint on one of your leaves that's been painted green, it's very easy to clean out any unwanted areas. Let me talk to you also about something that I'm not using a lot in my classes anymore, the Clicker retractable eraser. Most of the time, in the earlier stages of my oil rouging projects, I worked on very light backgrounds like white canvas, white base coated wood, white base coated slate. And now that I'm working on a pattern background, let me bring this into the focus for you. I'm working with scrapbook paper. So the little mistakes that I made that I used to be really worried about cleaning out meticulously don't really impair as much anymore because of the fact that I've got the pattern background. But if I did want to remove paint, I want to show you how easy this is. You take the Clicker retractable eraser, and what you do is literally you can erase color. So if I didn't want paint in my leaves, and I did need them perfectly clean, I could clean them out with the Clicker eraser and then take my mop brush and dust the crumbs off so that I don't smear my work. But in most cases for larger areas like this, just placing your finger over a Q-tip is all that's needed to remove any unwanted paint. So it's nice to have that Clicker retractable eraser there. And what I like to do also is when this starts to get really worn, I'll take an X-Acto knife and just chop it a little so that I can keep, you know, pushing a little bit more out, getting a nice crisp edge. So if I do have to clean up a long, really tight area, I can incorporate that and then dust off the crumbs and not disturb my oil rouging. Okay? So what we've covered basically is adding the color, maintaining control of the brush, making sure that you use the right size brush in the area that you're working in. Okay? One other thing that I'd like to share with you is a little trick, and this is where a lot of people have issues with rouging, and that's working with snow. So I'm going to move this off to the side, and I'm going to bring a new picture into the process here. So you can see what I've gotten so far. This is a new design I'm just working on now, and I haven't started my rouging yet. But I thought as long as I was showing you tricks for oil rouging, I would also incorporate things like snow drifts, okay? This is where it can really impact the end result of your surface or your work, okay? So what I'm gonna do first is I'm going to clean my liner brush out in my dirty gel. And this surface has been inked. It's been decoupaged with the scrapbook paper onto a piece of MDF. And then what I did is I sprayed it. And I'm ready now to incorporate my rouging. So let me give you a little example of snow. Let me turn this around. Watch how I can make this area here. I can make these trees look like they're actually sunk into the snow. I'm going to go to straight Payne's Gray. I'm not going to incorporate any gel. And what I'm going to do is right at the base of this tree right here, watch how I'm going to set a line of paint. Notice that it rests right at the bottom of the branch or the trunk. I'm going to take my number 6 blender. I'm going to swirl it and clean it really good. And then I'm going to take the tip of the brush. It goes where the color is the darkest. You don't cross the line. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to rouge towards me and bring the color up and out and away. Look at that. Nice, subtle. I call this the apple. It's like comparing it to doing the smile of an apple. If this was an apple here, and this was my stem coming out of the core, this is where the smile would incorporate. And notice how I'm just softening and softening so that as I'm incorporating this, my color is the deepest where the branch goes right down into the snow and then it gradually gets lighter and lighter and lighter. But at any point, I never cross the line and go over like this because then you're gonna lose your line of definition. Now, let me back up a little and I wanna show you a couple do's and don'ts. Look at how easy that was to correct. It's so much fun. That's why I love teaching beginner students how to do oil rouging. So let me turn this around now. I showed you a do, now I want to show you a don't. A don't would be to put your line of color too far below where the trunk goes down into the snow. When you incorporate your rouging and you blend the color up and out, it looks like the tree trunk is floating above the crevice in the snow. So that doesn't look very good. So let's get rid of this. And I want to show you another don't. Keep your Q-tips close by. They are really a wonderful tool. Now I'm going to show you another don't. A lot of people will do this and incorporate the snow above where the tree trunk is. And then it looks like the tree trunk is in front of, or it's in front of the depth of the snow. So that's another don't, okay? So just bear with me and watch how I incorporate this and they actually make this area of trees look like it's sunk into the snow. I'm going to bring this right across, like so. Again, following the rule that the shadow in the snow only goes to the base of the tree trunk or branch that's coming out of the snow. Rouge the color up and away. Like so. Soften the edges so that it virtually disappears. And it's funny because when I teach down in Florida, I have my Florida students telling me, well, we can't do snow because we don't have any snow down in Florida. And I say, yes, but you have sand on the beach, don't you? And if you're painting a picture of a seascape or a beach scene, all you would do is change your colors to represent the sandy beach. And it's the same principle. Look at that. And see how it looks like the branch is coming out of the snow. And then I'm softening the edges so that it virtually disappears and it truly looks like a shadow in the snow. Okay. All right, so if I wanted to go in and add a few random divots in the snow, I'm going to turn my work so you can see this up close. Again, work from behind. I'm working towards me. Now you can really see how that Lazy Susan would be an asset if you're working, especially if you're working on something like a big, heavy piece of slate. Do you have to keep picking the slate up and moving it on your work area? Could be kind of frustrating. But if you had a nice Lazy Susan, you could just turn your work, swirl it, or work gently. Keep rotating. Now see how I added more shadows in the snow? Let's put a little one back in here. What you have to remember too when you're working with things like this is you don't want everything to be the same size, the same length. You want to have differences so it doesn't look regimented. And again, fade your edges off to nothing. If you do end up with a little bit of paint over the area that you don't want, turn your work, take a Q-tip, and just gently clean up in front of the divot, and it'll put it all back into perspective again. So if you look at this now, let me just lift this up a little bit so we can get a good shot of it. And it looks like the tree branches are coming up out of the snow. Isn't that a neat trick? Okay? This pattern is going to be finished, and I'll probably be submitting it for one of the conventions, so you won't be seeing it available right away. Okay? But I love doing snow scenes. I think it's a lot of fun. So, in closing now, what I want to share with you is another little trick of mine. And there's a big misconception with oil paint. And I want to move this out of the way. Most people don't realize that oil paint is a oil-based process, or a product. Oil paint is basically linseed oil with an additive of pigment or color. The gel that I use is linseed oil that Martin Weber has transformed for me into a gel form instead of liquid. So when I add a little bit of gel to my oil colors, which are basically linseed oil based also, that means at the very end of your painting session, you don't have to use any odorless terp, nothing, no smelly mediums. All I do is take a little bit of water, I take a little bit of soap, and watch this. I'm going to take my brush, swish it in water, run it on the bar of soap. And just like your shampoo bottles will tell you, rinse, lather, repeat until you don't see any paint come out on your on the soap. And this is all I do to clean my brushes. Now I use this for my scumblers. And you can see how nice and clean this is coming out. And watch this with my liner. Same thing. Swish, work the brush on the bar of soap, express all that paint out of there, continue to rinse, lather, repeat, and look at how clean my brush is coming. This is all I do with my brushes. Big misconception. People are just kind of blown away when they see that I don't bring any mediums into my technique at all. Now, same thing with my blenders. When you're done at the end of the day, you take your blender brushes and you incorporate the same thing. Soap and water. I'm using a little tub here, but actually if you're standing at your kitchen sink or your utility tub and you're rinsing underwater, you're going to have a lot easier time of keeping your brushes clean. And you could look and see how that paint is working its way right out of those bristles. So I do this with my blender brushes. And then afterwards, I pinch press them gently and then lay them out on a towel to dry. And the next time I'm painting, I have a very successful experience. Okay? So I hope this has helped you. I welcome any questions. You can email me. And we also have our phone number too. So if you need help with anything, please feel free to call me. Okay? Thank you very much.